I think one of the funniest things I've ever heard in regards to the breathing method is, well, why should I read that? I mean, it wasn't even good enough for them to make a movie out of. Well, I'm here to tell you. The most important things are the hardest to say. They are the things you get ashamed of because words make them smaller. When they were in your head, they were limitless, but once they come out, they seem to be no bigger than normal things. But that's not all. The most important things lie too close to wherever your secret heart is buried. They are clues that could guide your enemies to a prize they would love to steal. It's hard and painful for you to talk about these things, and then people just look at you strangely. They haven't understood what you've said at all, or why you almost cried while you were saying it. Love isn't soft like those poets say. Love has teeth, which bite, and the wounds never close. I want to hear about it, that's all. That's all they want, really. The firing squads, the gas chambers, the ovens, the guys who had to dig their own graves and then stand on the end so they'd fall into them, the examinations, the experiments, everything. All the gushy stuff. You are the monster. Homesickness is not always a vague, nostalgic, almost beautiful emotion, although that is somehow the way we always seem to picture it in our mind. It can be a terribly keen blade, not just a sickness in metaphor, but in fact as well. It can change the way one looks at the world. The faces one sees in the street look not just different, but ugly, perhaps even malignant. Homesickness is a real sickness, the ache of the uprooted plant. Yes, some birds are just not meant to be caged, that's all. Their feathers are too bright, their songs too sweet and wild. So you let them go, but when you open the cage to feed them, they somehow fly out past you. And part of you knows that it was wrong to imprison them in the first place. But still, the place where you live is that much more drab and empty for their departure. Always remember that hope is a good thing, maybe the best of things, and no good thing ever dies. It always comes down to just two choices: get busy living or get busy dying. Hey, what's up, bookworms and constant readers? Mike back to go reverse order back into the multiverse and talk about the final story in 1982's Different Seasons. Today, we're going to be talking about The Breathing Method, like I said, from 1982. I apologize about doing these out of order, guys. I did that big thing in October with Fright Fest, and I just kind of ran out of time to do the fourth story there, Breathing Method. But we are going to leave no stone unturned when it comes to the multiverse, and that means we're going back into the multiverse to talk about The Breathing Method. If you guys don't know what I'm doing with Into the Multiverse, I am going through all of Stephen King's bibliography in publication order based off of books that released under his own name. We'll get to the Richard Bachman stuff later. But again, if you've watched the other Different Season reviews, you know how this goes. But this story here, labeled A Winter's Tale, as it takes place around Christmas time, I feel like this one is kind of the ugly duckling of this book, just because you think At Pupil, Shawshank Redemption, The Body, aka Stand By Me, are just so revered and iconic that a lot of people just kind of forget about this book because it hasn't gotten a big budget Hollywood adaptation. And I think there might be some of that involved, but I don't know. Let's get into what is the book about. Now, this one takes place in this strange club in New York where men tell each other stories. Now, the years pass, but no one looks any older. One night, a doctor tells a story of a pregnant young woman who was killed in a gruesome way, but is somehow still alive, and she is able to deliver her baby. Now, it's a tale of evil, psychic powers, obsession, alternate realities, and the supernatural in the most ordinary way in everyday places. And I think it is a very deep dive into the human mind, which might be a little different than people were expecting from Stephen King at this time. But let's get into what makes it good or bad. Now, first off, good. I like that it is what is known as a frame tale. If you know what a frame tale is, that's a story within a story. I think it takes it to new places that we weren't really used to with King at this point. You know, Dark Tower had only had one book out. We hadn't really dealt with like alternate realities or the possibility of multiple realities, parallel dimensions, things like that. And again, if it does do that, it kind of leaves it up to the reader to determine if that is what is actually happening or if it's just a study of how the human mind can cope with seeing something traumatic and how it can project a different reality. It deals a lot, I think, with mental illness. And this is something I think that he would touch on much, much more in later series. But for now, this was kind of his first steps into dealing with things like that. You know, he did like the Dead Zone, which obviously dealt with, you know, brain injury and things like that. But this is something completely different. This is like how the mind can actually shape a new reality to help you escape from the one that you actually live in. I think that this is a the idea of creating an alternate reality for yourself to live in really deals with what dissociative disorder, things like that, is things that I think that really people weren't really talking about very much. And I always say that King always was the one who was going to talk about these things that were tough to talk about, find a way to insert them into his stories. And it was something that mental illness is always something. If you've watched my Brandon Sanderson stuff, you know that I think mental illness is something that we have a hard time dealing with, at least in the States. And we always just kind of want to shove these things off and just like kind of pretend that they don't exist. But with this, I felt like it's something that he will put very much up at the forefront. And even if he didn't come out and straight say, yes, that's what this is, he leaves it up to you to interpret that. I think it's something that we needed to talk about. So not only is it a fascinating look into the human psyche, I feel like this book has two major themes. The first one is being that if you question your imagination, you lose your creativity. And I think that that is kind of a double entendre. Obviously, he's talking about what it's like being a writer as well. I mean, I feel like he's always kind of projected in his writing, especially during that hot streak of 74 to 86. He would always kind of, you know, do that real meta approach to everything. But with this one, it deals with a lot of, I keep saying alternate reality, but you kind of got to read it to understand what I'm talking about here. You know, it's this kind of imaginary world. It's something that again, when I get into multiverse connections, I'll talk about the Dark Tower kind of relation here. But the other theme is homesickness. There's a passage in here, and you guys know I don't like to gush about prose or writing style or anything like that, but I feel like it needs to hear. There's a passage, I actually use an intro, where he's talking about homesickness and how it is a very real sickness. Now, I think the reason that resonated with me is I've told you guys about my Great Awakening, as I called it, when I first discovered Stephen King books at my high school library in 1993, and I read all of them. I had just moved to Houston as a 15-year-old, knew absolutely no one in the whole state. It was a decision my parents made. And I said, okay, I'm just going to just kind of bury my nose in books. And obviously, I was very homesick. I'd lived in Atlanta my whole life. It was still one of those things where I was like, oh, I got to get back somehow. Yeah, I'm still living in Houston, by the way. Anyway, at 15 years old, that's something that's very, very real. And I feel like homesickness was something I was really struggling with at 15 when I read this book. You know, I hadn't even been here a year yet when I read this story. So I think that that was something that you may not think is a theme of this book, but the way that he puts it in there, I'm like, that absolutely hit me right here. And I think that his writing prowess is on display in this collection. That's why I keep telling everyone that if you think that Stephen King is not a wonderful writer, you very clearly never read Different Seasons, because he is a wordsmith for sure when he wants to be. And in these four stories, he absolutely wants to be. And that passage about homesickness being a very real sickness and the pain of the uprooted plant, it just stuck in my memory. It just absolutely encapsulated how I felt at that moment, being in a new place away from everyone that I knew and loved and just completely isolated. I didn't know anybody. It was it was really hard to make friends when you're always the kid sticking his nose in a Stephen King book in the high school library at 15 years old, right? Let's get into a couple of bad things here. And again, this is all subjective. This is really going to depend on you. A lot of people have a hard time with short stories, myself included. I say like a short story collections, I have a hard time because I feel like when they're getting going, they end. This one isn't a short story. It's technically a novella, but it's very short. 66 pages. The shortest story in this book. It's really over before you know it. And it is a slow burn at the same time. So a lot of people consider that a negative. And that's why this is probably going to be the shortest review here. Because without getting into spoilers, I can't really talk too much about the actual storyline, because there's not a lot of meat on that bone. It really is a slow burn. And then it has like that ending that makes you, that, you know, gives the thought-provoking ending where you're like, okay. Not a lot of development for any of the characters in this outside of David, and even that is kind of questionable. So you never really get a real attachment to the character. Again, like I keep saying, it's just about other things. I feel like the other three stories in this are damn near iconic. Like I said, I feel like everyone has heard of those stories, at least if they haven't read them or know them or seen the movie. They at least know what they're about. And this feels kind of anticlimactic to end this book with this story. So I feel like it's just kind of a pale contrast compared to the other books in here that are all, you know, optimistic and have this wonderful approach to things. Really make you think about, you know, childhood, make you think about hope, make you think about just absolutely, you know, the real, who the real monsters are or whatever. And then you have this story that's kind of like a completely different peep into the human psyche, and it's just like, that's just different. So if I could change anything, I would just change the order of the books. I'd probably put this second or third in with one of the more popular stories. I don't know. Again, how do you know what was going to be popular when he actually published this? So that's really a dumb thing to put under bad. But again, I got a nitpick to find bad things about King, so you guys don't just think I'm throwing my credit card at the screen all the time. Let's get into why you should read it. And guys, it's the same reason I've been saying. The reason that I recommend different seasons to everyone who was first getting into Stephen King is because it's not horror, and it really shows off his chops as a writer. That's why I always recommend different seasons to Where Should I Start with Stephen King. It's the best place to start if you're not looking to have your pants shitted, you know? So I will always say that this story, I think it's been kind of misunderstood. Again, I think it is definitely a victim of the power of the other three stories, and people always just kind of... It's not because it hasn't had a movie made. I think that's just weird that people say that. I think it's just because you've had three hit movies. That Pupil was kind of questionable if it was a hit or not, but, you know, it made its money. So I think that I really think that people kind of judge it off of that. You know, the other three are just iconic, and this one's just kind of like, what is that about? To me, I was hooked right away from the ideas behind it. But again, I think it's going to depend on you. If you're wanting just kind of, it's very different from the other three stories in this book. But if it's something that you're really, really into, dealing with mental illness, I think that you could probably find something that you like there. You know, dissociative identity disorder is something that King would deal with later in his books, and I'll talk about that in Multiverse Connections, and I'll be talking about that early next year as I continue a particular series in Into the Multiverse. But I can't think of a story much like this one. And it's very quick read. Like I said, you can read this in kind of one sitting, 66 pages. I don't think you have it. It is a slow burn, but again, I don't think that there's a real breaking point where you can be like, I'm going to break that into a couple days. I think you can really just finish it in one sitting. And I think it'll leave you with some thoughts. As for thoughts, my final thoughts are, yes, this is my least favorite story in different seasons. But again, look what it's going up against. You know, if you've watched those other three reviews, you see how much I love those other three stories. But the only reason that this is considered not great is because of the weight of those other three stories in this. Dissociative identity disorder, like I said, something he expands upon on Dark Tower. And I truly believe that there's a character in Dark Tower that this was the basis of where he came up with the ideas for that character. And I won't mention that character now, but if you know, you know. And for those who know, I'm going to get into spoilers now as I talk about a couple of Multiverse Connections. I don't think there's anything that's going to ruin anything for you, but I'd like to give you that warning just in case. Skeleton Crew is the obvious one here. The Man Who Would Not Shake Hands is a story in there. It has the butler and the strange club in Manhattan that is visited in this story, and that is the only major crossover within the multiverse. Like I said, Different Seasons isn't a real big multiverse book. A couple of these stories really only kind of cross with other stories in this book. This one deals with, yes, that story of Skeleton Crew. But here's one that I'm just going to kind of spitball on, as I feel like a big theme in The Dark Tower is, you know, there are other worlds in these, alternate realities, parallel dimensions, things like that, different path of the beam. I don't know how much of this actually is this imaginary world, or if this is actually, you know, a different world. That's always something I've kind of wondered as I got really deeper into Dark Tower. I remember this before I read Dark Tower, but it's one that, you know, revisiting, I thought, huh, I wonder if that really does kind of cross over there. So Odetta Holmes is the one in that has a dissociative identity disorder. And I really believe that this character, that's where the ideas for Odetta kind of came from, was from this. So it's fun to look at it as being like, this is the roots that kind of grew that character. So I can't really call it a connection as much as I think this might be where he came, the genesis of the idea of Odetta in that book. And I think that that's just a really cool idea. Anytime I have any kind of crossover with Dark Tower, which is just about anything that he writes, it's always a really cool wrinkle. So again, that might just be guessing on my part. I don't know. It's not for sure a crossover, but there's not very many in different seasons. And guys, that was different seasons. Again, I apologize for the delay, but I wanted to make sure that we are going the completionist route here. And this is a story I really, like I said, I don't think I can talk about too much because it's such a short read. I feel like you'd be like, you just kind of like told me everything I need to know. Why do I need to keep reading? But again, I think it's a very good look inside the old noggin, and I think that you'll find something that you like. So stay tuned, guys. We'll be going into the multiverse in December. We'll be going back for The Talisman. That's going to be my first read of The Talisman, and I'm very much looking forward to it because I liked Eyes of the Dragon way more than I expected. So we will talk to you guys there. Have yourselves a great Thanksgiving.